Working 9 to 5 has become the American way.
These so-called menial jobs, like milking a cow or pushing a broom, these are God's way of feeding us. They are vehicles for God's loving care of His own.
Discover how you can connect your work to God's work on today's 700 Club Interactive. On 700 Club Interactive, we use technology to pray for each other and explore topics that matter to you. Watch what God is doing in the world today. Welcome to the program. Work seems to be a part of American culture. And many Americans, if you look at the surveys, are not making a living doing something they enjoy. Well, today we're going to talk to author Tim Keller. He believes that no matter your profession or pay grade, you can find meaning and purpose in the workplace. Watch this.
An actor many, many years ago who had become a Christian at Redeemer came in and sat down and started asking me questions. He says, I'm really excited about being a Christian in every area of my life, so I have a couple questions. For example, he says, what kind of roles can I take and what kind of stories can I tell? He says, now I'm sure that I don't have to only act in stories and plays and movies and TV shows in which a person becomes a Christian at the end. I know that. But he says, there's a lot of stories that seem to be not very redemptive, and maybe the story doesn't have to be redemptive. So he asked all these questions, what kind of roles can I take as a Christian? And what roles should I not take? I realized that in some areas of discipleship, because I'm theologically trained, it is almost one way. People come and say, I want to know how to evangelize people better. Well, all right, I know more than you do about that. I'll help you. But when a financial person asks about short selling, when an actor comes and asks about what kind of roles and stories can I tell, I have some theological insights. The person understands their field. And we actually stand almost equal. And in fellowship and community, we have to try to become wiser. All work is rearranging the raw material of God's creation for the purpose of human flourishing. In the process, you make money, and sometimes you even get self-esteem. But if money and self-esteem is the main reason you work, the work will be boring and very often it won't add to other people's lives.
Well, joining us now via Skype is that author, Tim Keller. He's the author of Every Good Endeavor, and welcome to 700 Club Interactive.
Hi, glad to be here.
In your book, you start off that, you know, the work is actually part of the gospel, part of the Bible. The Genesis begins with God working. What would you say to the person who says that they don't think they're called to work?
Well, in paradise, and when everything was perfect, when we were first created by God, we were put into the Garden of Eden, and we were put there to work. We were put there to till the garden and take care of it. And so what that means, actually, is that we were obviously built for work. Work must be part of our design, and work is something we need to be fulfilled and happy. So we actually need to work because we were built to work. So anybody who says, I'm just not cut out for that, is that's a superficial analysis, and they don't know their own heart.
In our modern culture, modern American culture, we seem to have gotten a divide, if you will, between the sacred and the secular. And you look back in the history, particularly of New England, where work was considered a calling, and it was part of your service to God. We've gotten a way far away from that. How do we get back to that, and how do we bridge this divide?
Well, you can only be called to do something by somebody else. In other words, if you just decide to do something, then you've decided to do it. If you are called to it, it means someone else has asked you to do it. Therefore, ultimately, the idea of work as a calling depends on a belief in God. And yet, I think it's fair to say that there's a lot of people who don't know what they believe about God, that are still, they still realize that work as strictly something I do for self-fulfillment and self-advancement isn't right. And so you can actually lay out the idea of thinking about work as a calling to serve other people and serve the greater good.
And a lot of non-Christians resonate to that. And on the way, I think, can be brought into seeing the importance of belief in God. So I actually do think that people, as long as you're laying out in front of people the vision of work as serving others and serving the greater good rather than just a means of individual advancement, you're putting them on the path toward believing in work as calling. Very important for us to recapture that idea of work as calling.
Well, part of your book, you go into the work actually forms the culture. And we've got, I would say that we've gotten way far away from that. And even looking at how can I serve the greater good through what I do.
Right.
And it's really devolved into how can I make the most money? Or,
yes.
Or how can I make some, the, you know, profit being the prime motive as opposed to serving the broader community.
Yeah. And I think, in principle, I think a lot, more and more people are seeing that. More and more people are saying, well, television. Should I produce a television program that makes me a ton of money? Or should I produce something that is probably better for people, better for the culture, better for people's moral fiber, better for giving people encouragement and hope? Very often, what would probably benefit people and what would make me money aren't the same, and we choose what will make me more money. And most people know that's intuitively wrong. But when you actually get into a situation in which you've got the temptation to do something which is not wrong per se, it's not a sin, and yet it's really not helping people, and yet it'll make you a lot of money, it's very tempting just to go along with it.
Oh, you can certainly look back at the 2008 financial crisis and all the derivative instruments. Those are sort of prime examples where there's no thought paid to, can this mortgage be paid off, and it's just how can we repackage it and sell it?
Yeah, and if you think about it, now I try to be sympathetic. I realize that if you're in a situation where you're in the financial world and you know that if you do this deal, you'll make $15 million and you'll be on your way, you say, well, it's not illegal, it's not really immoral, it may not really help a lot of people. It might blow up on people. It might not be good for society. But I'm going to make my $15 million. It's, when I say I'm sympathetic, I understand it, but it's wrong. And therefore, this idea of work as for me instead of for others and for God is destroying us.
How can we get back to the sense that work brings personal fulfillment? You look at the surveys today, and a lot of people are really unhappy in what they do on the day-to-day. How do we get to a level that it's fulfilling?
Now, that's a good question in this way. An awful lot of things in the Christian life are fulfilling as a byproduct. So, for example, if I, actually C.S. Lewis, I think, somewhere says, aim at heaven, you'll get earth thrown in. Aim at earth, and you'll get neither. And it's his way of saying, I will be happy if I put loving God and loving my neighbor ahead of my own happiness. In other words, if I serve God rather than be happy, if I love other people rather than trying to just serve my own happiness, in the long run, I'll be more happy. The irony is, seek your happiness first, and you won't be as happy. Seek other people to serve other people, and you will be happy as a byproduct. And I think in many ways, people, because they're actually seeking work that is only incredibly satisfying and incredibly lucrative, ironically, they're experiencing more and more unfulfilling work.
Isn't one of the keys trying to find things that will actually help other people?
Yes.
And satisfy other people? And it's kind of strange that if you do, if you pursue that, then suddenly you'll find your own fulfillment at the same time. It's almost like you stumble into it if you orient yourself that way.
Absolutely right. But it does help to have a biblical view of things, because when you and I think of something that will help other people, sometimes we are thinking a little too, too grand a scale. Martin Luther was wonderful at explaining this. He said, the Bible, at a number of places, the Bible says God feeds every living thing. Then he says, okay, but how does God do that? He doesn't actually literally put the food on your table. He says that means that the humblest farm girl who is milking a cow, and then the rough truck driver who's bringing the milk to the grocer, and then the grocer, he says these so-called menial jobs, like milking a cow or pushing a broom or a mechanic that's keeping the truck running, these are God's way of feeding us. So all these people doing so-called menial things need to realize theologically and biblically that what they're doing is actually, they are vehicles for God's loving care of his own. And so it's to say I need to do something that helps people is absolutely right, but let's be careful not to suddenly think that that means I'm curing cancer or something like that.
Yeah, it could be you're just delivering a cup of cold water.
Exactly.
What do you mean by the power of deep rest? You get into that later in the book. What do you mean by that? And have we lost that today? It seems like we're so busy we never even take a Sabbath rest.
Yeah, thanks for asking me that one too. Yeah, well, now at the physical level, most people understand that you have got to take care of your body and your mind so that you don't work all the time. If you work too much, it runs you into the ground, and therefore you need to take time off, you need to have Sabbath, you need to restore your batteries. Most people understand that. What I mean by deep rest, though, is in the Bible, especially in, say, the book of Hebrews and the New Testament tells us that God's Sabbath rest from work is a pointer to a very deep kind of rest. In Hebrews, it talks about the fact that we have to rest from our good works, and this is what I mean by deep rest in a nutshell. There's underneath our work, sometimes we're actually trying to earn our salvation. We wouldn't say that, but many of us feel like unless I'm very successful, unless I do well, unless I make money, I won't like myself, I won't feel significant, and therefore there's a work underneath the work, and the work is we're really trying to develop our own self-image, and we're trying to create our own self-esteem through our work. That is exhausting. And so you're working at one level, you're putting in 50 hours a week or 60 hours a week, you say, I need to take some time off. But you need to get the deeper rest underneath that. And you need to say, I'm accepted in Christ, I'm loved by God, I don't have to earn my self-esteem through my work. And if you, in other words, get the deep rest of the gospel, that makes it easier to physically work in a way that doesn't exhaust you as well.
I love how you tied it in with John Coltrane. I'm a real jazz fan, and the liner notes to his Love Supreme and the performance he gave one time, and then he's leaving the stage and he quotes from the Gospel of Luke the words of Simeon, right. Now dismiss your servant. You know, he had done what he considered to be the ultimate performance of that suite. Right. And he was able to just take supreme satisfaction in it, not for anything other than it was an act of worship. And he models it after Simeon, that who lived his life righteously in the temple. And his one thing he had to do was to see the Savior and announce it, that he's seen it. And then he says, now dismiss your servant. How can we get to that kind of mindfulness in our day-to-day that we sometimes miss perhaps the assignment that God has for us? How can we get back into that kind of rest where we're not looking to perform, we're just looking to observe and appreciate what God has already put in place for us?
Well, the way you just posed that question was a great step in the right direction. Just to think that you need to be able to realize that that's our task. The way you expressed it was great. Most of us don't even realize that's the task. Most of us don't even see that as the challenge. But then how do we get that mindfulness? It's really no different than asking the question, how can we practice God's presence during the day? How can we be better wife or husband? How can we express the love of Jesus more to our spouse? Mindfulness comes through using what you might call the means of grace, the ordinary means of grace. It means personal prayer and devotion. It means accountability. You have some other friends who are maybe in the same situation, who are Christians, who are trying to do the same thing. And so you meet every couple of weeks to talk about how well you're doing. So it's accountability, it's prayer, but actually it's also conceiving of the task the way you just expressed it.
Well, Tim, thanks for the book. Very thought-provoking. For more information on his work, you can go to 700 Club Interactive. And his book, Every Good Endeavor, is available nationwide. Tim, thanks for being with us, and thanks again for the book. Very thought-provoking.
Thank you.
Well, coming up, she lost her father and nearly her life. Find out how your support gave one girl a chance right after this.
I started feeling pain between my spine and my shoulder blade. All I had was pain and no relief. There was a sizable mass consistent with a malignant cancer in upper right lung. And that's complex, that's tough stuff. I was walking, talking, but I didn't know how sick I was.
I remembered seeing the ad for Cancer Treatment Centers of America, and I thought, this is the place he needs to be.
To find out more about Cancer Treatment Centers of America and our unique treatment options for complex and advanced stage cancer, go to cancercenter.com. You'll be able to see our treatment results for many types of cancers and how they compare to national averages. You can also check for participating insurance plans.
The game plan was chemotherapy and radiation throughout the whole period. It was an aggressive plan of attack. I liked that.
We gave him chemotherapy and radiation. He was an amazing patient. He tolerated treatment exceptionally well.
Cancer Treatment Centers of America is different. You feel it the moment you call or walk into one of our hospitals. It's state-of-the-art medicine, unique treatment options, and a level of compassion that cannot be copied. Why? Our people. People who give you not only their expertise, but their humanity, and the most thoughtful, well-organized, patient-centered care you'll find anywhere.
My strength came back. I began to become myself again.
George does have his life back now. He has a life that I never thought he was gonna have.
With the teamwork, the treatment plans, the facilities, the combination of all the aspects of the treatment, I'm so happy that I went to CTCA.
Every minute counts when you're fighting complex or advanced stage cancer, so please call or visit cancercenter.com today. Appointments are available now. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, care that never quits.
A young artist learns a hard lesson about fame.
I started producing for drug dealers, pimps, thugs.
Until he came face to face with his reality.
They came in with automatic weapons, had all my guys laid down. I'm getting ready to put a hit out on somebody.
Find out how Canton Jones went from bad boy to gospel great on the next 700 Club Interactive. When a typhoon tore the roof off of one Vietnamese school, it didn't just cancel classes. It also nearly ruined one girl's chance of having a life.
At this trade school in Vietnam, teens from poor families, like Luong, are being taught skills that will help her support her family. In just a few months, she's already begun to master this needlework art form.
At first, it was difficult to learn the sewing techniques, but soon, I was enjoying my work and was getting better at it.
Over the past year, Luong has been trying to find ways to make money to help support her widowed mother and siblings. It wasn't until she came to this school for orphans and street kids that she began to have hope. That's when a typhoon hit that could have closed the school for good.
Even though we prepared for the typhoon, we didn't expect it to bring such devastation. It took us 7 days just to throw out the garbage and clean out the mess.
And there was no money to replace the roof that had blown off in the typhoon.
I was especially concerned about Long. She has really become the breadwinner since her father died.
The school's director called CBN's office in Vietnam to see if we could help. That's when Orphans Promise provided all the money they needed to replace the school's roof and to make the necessary repairs inside the building. That meant Luong would be able to return to school and finish her training.
I could hardly believe it. I was dancing in my heart. Thank you.
I am very excited about this new business you are teaching me. Thank you for helping us.
And if you're a member of the 700 Club, thank you, because you're part of helping that wonderful girl. You're part of helping people around the world, because a portion of every gift goes in the work of CBN International to preach the gospel, sometimes in very tangible ways, to people around the world. If you're not a member, join with us. Call the number. It's toll-free, 888-777-1999. When you call, ask for Pledge Express. That's electronic monthly giving. The bank does all the work. There's no checks to write, nothing to mail in. And we save so much in the processing we can send as our gift back to you, Power for Life, monthly teaching CDs. So if you like that, ask for Pledge Express when you call. And if you want to designate your gift to help the orphans around the world, all you have to do is say, I want to give to Orphans Promise. And 100% of your gift will go into over 50 countries around the world helping orphans with their needs. So if you'd like to designate to Orphans Promise, you can do it on CBN.com or just when you call, say, I want to give to Orphans Promise. Well, still ahead, one young woman moves to the city to make it big, only to find out she can't have it all. Right after this.
If you're the mother of a child with behavior problems, I'd like to talk to you. My name is Janet Lehman, and I'm a behavioral therapist and a mom. I know what it's like when the child that you love becomes a defiant, out-of-control child who disrespects you.
That's why my husband James and I created the Total Transformation, the program that tens of thousands of moms are now using to turn around their child's behavior.
If you've heard about the Total Transformation and wondered if it will work for you, now you can try it for free. I'm willing to give away 1,000 programs today for free.
All you need to do is get the program and let us know how it works for you. We'll let you keep it for free.
I know the Total Transformation works because I used these techniques with my own son and with troubled kids for over 30 years. Let me prove to you that it works by giving you the program free.
Call the number on your screen now to get the Total Transformation free.
Creed's sound was definitely rock and roll, and their meaningful lyrics touched fans in a whole new way. But those words hit a troubled past and a tenuous relationship with God.
I was a Christian who was in rebellion. It became an obsession, if you will. And it was my way out.
The faith journey of Creed's former lead singer, Scott Stapp. On the 700 Club, next.
Success came naturally to Janet Hill. But finding the right balance between her work and her life, well, that was the hard part.
Janet Hill moved to New York City right out of college with no job and no place to live. Just the desire to make it big in the publishing industry. She started in an entry-level position and worked her way up to vice president of Doubleday Publishing in 2000.
I worked very hard. I was working so much that that's the thing that I think ultimately, you know, got me off track. You work hard, and you get promoted, and you work hard some more, and you get promoted, and you think you're doing it on your own steam, and you're not.
Janet grew up in a Christian home and was baptized at the age of 8. But life as a young single professional in New York City was a far cry from the quiet, simple life she left behind.
It's very hectic, and you know, I had a very, you know, busy job, a demanding job, and I lived, you know, 600 miles away from my family, and I was the only one here, and I certainly had wonderful friends, but you need sometimes closer than friends. I was treated for depression. I mean, there was still something missing, but I was coping because you have to, and you just try a little harder, you push a little harder, but again, as you do that, the more you try and the more you try to pretend that everything is okay and you're feeling fine, you're feeling great, the more energy you have to expend and the more exhausting it becomes.
Janet knew she was close to her breaking point when she refused to even acknowledge her own birthday.
You know, and all I wanted to do that day was stay in bed, but I knew that I couldn't. I had to go to work. You know, got my clothes out. I set up my ironing board in my little hallway in my old apartment, started ironing, and then I just started feeling so upset. And so I did feel overwhelmed. And I just thought, okay, what can I do? I can get down on my knees and I can pray, and I'm going to pray right here, and I'm just going to ask God to help me. And I just said, you know, please have mercy on me. Just help me. I cannot do this alone. I can't, you know, I just can't do this. And as I, you know, got back up, I started to feel better, and I started to iron my clothes, and I, you know, got dressed, and I, you know, made it through that day. And then, you know, I started to make it through the next day, and then I started to read my Bible, and then I'd get up you know, early in the morning and read the Bible. And that was amazing because I began to feel, you know, calmer and stronger.
Janet says God led her away from publishing to a new career. She started her own jewelry line, On This Rock.
I want people to feel comforted. I mean, we're living in dark days now, you know, and to have, like, this is Proverbs, you know, 3:5, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. This is the 23rd Psalm. And to wear the scripture, it's comforting. At least it's comforting for me. People just need to hold to God's unchanging hand. Hold on to his hand and don't let go. And just know that he will lead you, he will guide you. Jesus is our shepherd. He will, you know, take us where he wants us to go, not where we want us to go. And then when you get there, you realize, oh, this is where I always wanted to be anyway.
Yeah, I learned the secret that God loves her and he wants good things for her. The world wants to lie to you. The world wants to tell you if you make so much money, then you'll be happy. Or if you get this particular position, you'll be happy. Or if you work hard and you advance yourself, you'll be happy. But so often we find that people who are climbing the corporate ladder at the top realize, well, they had the ladder leaning against the wrong building. And they're not happy with it. And they're not happy with the success. And they're not happy with their life. And they're wondering, well, what do I do now? How do I even get out of bed now? God came, Jesus came, that you might have life and have it more abundantly. And he made you, and he made you specifically and uniquely to do good works that he created for you to walk into before he even founded the earth. Now start thinking of that. Start thinking of the magnitude of that and how great a God we serve, that he's able to know your innermost desires, the things that will satisfy you, and he knows those things before he even made you. And so he made you unique so that you would be fulfilled by accomplishing them. When you understand that, then you embrace it. And no matter how mundane the task, you embrace it with joy because you know at the end of it, Jesus has something wonderful for you, that he's shaping all things together for your good, and you can approach each day with thanksgiving. Now, what does it take to get there? Same thing Janet did. Get on your knees. Ask him. If you need forgiveness for things, understand that if you'll confess your sins, he is faithful and just to forgive you and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Just take that first step of surrendering to him. And then start pursuing him and start saying, Lord, what do you have for me today? What good work for you do you have for me today? And be mindful of it and be looking out for it. And then when that prompting comes, you'll be the first to respond. Well, we've got inbox questions on this topic. Janice writes in, I've worked in the legal profession for 30 years. However, over the past few years, I've felt unhappy with my work. But because it provided a good paycheck, I stayed. Then I was laid off in October, started a new job immediately. 2 weeks later, I was laid off again. What should I do? Is God trying to change my path? Janice, I would say yes, he is. And the first clue for this is that you weren't happy. God wants to fulfill the desires of your heart. And so start asking yourself, what do I really want to do? So many people that I've met in the legal profession are very unhappy with it. They don't like to argue for a living all day. They want to have something that's a little more fulfilling. So start asking yourself, what makes me happy? And then pursue it. Let's go over to Marguerite for the next question.
Skuren, this is from Elizabeth. It seems I've always quit my jobs either to help my elderly dad or my kids. But now that my father is in the nursing home and my kids are all grown up, how do I find out what the Lord is calling me to do? How do I know what my next move is?
Elizabeth, I'll follow on with the same answer I gave to the previous one. What's in your heart? What do you love to do? And then ask yourself three questions. Number one is, what I'm proposing to do, is it good for God? Number two, is it good for other people? And then finally, number three, is it good for me? If all of those line up, then do it. That's all the time we have. We leave you this word from Colossians chapter 3. Whatever you do, in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. God bless you. We'll see you again.